Hello, today we will speak about Descartes' rule of science. So, we are here in our lecture notes. And we are in section 1.5. So let's go there. A little further. Here we are. So we need a cover sheet. Let's take today a yellow one. Okay, so Descartes' rule of science, what is it about? So it was announced by the French philosopher and scientist mathematician René Descartes in the year 1637. And what he did is that he stated without proof that the number of positive roots of a real polynomial is bounded from above by the number of sign changes in its sequence of coefficients. So let's look at one example that Descartes actually has used. So take a polynomial x to the 4 minus 4x to the 3 minus 19x squared plus 106 x minus 120, right? And you are interested, that's a real polynomial in one variable, a univariate polynomial, and you are interested in the number of positive roots and you count them with multiplicity, right? Okay, so, yeah, let's see. And he looks at the number of sign changes, so in their sequence of coefficients, which would here be 1, minus 4, minus 19, 106, minus 120. So you look just at the signs, plus or minus. So in this case, it would be plus, minus, minus, plus, minus, right? And if there is somewhere a zero, then you can ignore it, right? So if there is a monomial that's not appearing, you just ignore it. And when you look at the number of times that this sign changes, right? So it changes here, it changes here, and it changes here. So I have three sign changes. And when Descartes said, without giving a proof, that the number of positive roots of this polynomial, positive real roots of this polynomial, can be at most 3. That doesn't matter, but in fact here it is 3, namely 2, 3 and 4 are roots of this polynomial. And that's the only positive roots. The other root is minus 5, right? So you can easily verify this, but it's not important, you don't have to do this now. I mean, you can also, of course, use this rule to count the number of negative roots. You just have to substitute for x minus x, right? So if we do this, then the signs of all the odd degree monomials change, and those of the even degree monomials remain. So I have to change these two signs in this case. So the corresponding sequence of signs gets now plus, plus, minus, minus, minus. And here you see, in this case, we have only one sign change, right? So the number of negative roots can be at most one, okay? So Descartes actually... Descartes did not prove in full strength what we will prove today. Namely, there is an additional information that the number of positive roots has the same parity than the number of sign changes. So in our case, we had three positive roots and we had three sign changes. But a priori, it would be possible that we have less positive roots. If you have three sign changes, it cannot be that we have two positive roots counted with multiplicity, because two does not have the same parity. Two is an even number, whereas three is an odd number. So the only other possibility would be that there is one positive root, right? So in fact, using this information on a parity, we know that this polynomial must have a negative root, because if I look at this sequence of signs which I get when I substitute for x minus x, when I get plus plus minus minus minus, so I have one sign change. And I know when that there must be exactly one negative root counted with multiplicity. Okay. So this will be another information that we will get. And also we will get still another information, which was probably only proved about... in the 19th century, perhaps by Gauss, namely that if you have a real rooted polynomial, that's a polynomial all of whose complex roots are real, and this is an example of a real rooted polynomial, then the rule is actually exact, right? When a number of sign changes really equals the number of positive roots. And of course, you can also, in the same way, exactly count when the number of negative roots, right? So that's an additional information. And because this polynomial has only real roots, but that's another question how to see this. We will treat that later in the course. If you know that already, then you know that since you have three sign changes, there must be exactly three positive roots. And in fact, there are, as I said already, right? Namely, there are 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so that's Descartes' rule of signs. And we will, of course, prove it also for real closed fields. We will try to do everything for real closed fields now, if possible. And here we succeed. So it will hold for real closed fields. And that will enable us to count a number of roots of polynomials over real closed fields exactly, even if they are not real rooted, right? Even if not of all their roots in the algebraic closure are actually contained in the real closed field. Even in that case, we will be able to count exactly. With some tricks we will later find, right? So that we don't count the roots of the original polynomial, but of another polynomial. We will come to that later. So Descartes' rule of sign will be very crucial to count the number of real roots, in the sense that they are contained in the real closed field that we consider. That will be a crucial ingredient for the real quantifier elimination that we will prove later. But that's now going too far. Now let's perhaps first give a little intuition why the number of sign changes has to do something with the number of positive real roots. That's just an intuition, that's really not a proof at all. So the idea, I think, is more or less that, okay, look, let's just look at a real line. So R is a real closed field, but we have perhaps not so good intuition about it yet. So let's maybe say it's the real numbers. Anyway, we are just doing heuristics now. Okay, so here is the origin. And we are interested in the number of positive roots, and positive means greater than zero, so, right? And, what you probably know from high school is that the sine of a polynomial at infinity, so if you go to plus infinity, if you tend to plus infinity, then you know that the polynomial will eventually be positive, right? It will take positive values because the leading coefficient here is 1, right? If the sine, if you go to infinity, is determined by the sine of the leading coefficient, right? So the sine, if you go to infinity, is really determined by the sine of this coefficient, right? What happens if you go to zero, right? If you tend to zero on the positive real axis? Well, then the sine is certainly determined by the sine of a constant coefficient. At least if this is not zero, right? At least if it is not zero. If it is zero, then you have actually to look, if you are interested in the sign for a small positive epsilon here, then you have to look at the at this coefficient, at the linear coefficient, and if this is also zero, then you have to look at the next one, etc. So you have to look at the coefficient belonging to a monomial of smallest degree, right? And that coefficient will clearly determine the sign of that coefficient will clearly determine the sign of a polynomial on the positive real axis near zero, right? So in our case, it will be that the minus 120, we know that the polynomial will be it will actually be 1 minus 1, will tend to minus 120, okay, but doesn't matter now, so we know, but we know the sign is negative, we know it here it is somehow negative, and if you go to infinity, it's somehow positive, right? And so you have here, you must have a sign change between here and here, right, because you start here with plus and you end here with minus. Right, so there must be at least one sign change here in this sequence of signs, and that corresponds to the fact that you really, by the intermediate value theorem, you have to cross here the axis, right? There must be a zero in between here. Okay. So you see that sign changes might have to do something. Now the thing is, of course, a bit adventurous because you look at all signs of all coefficients, okay? So, but you know, the idea is perhaps that let's look at the graphs of the monomials themselves. So the constant monomial, let me draw this here with blue, the constant monomial on the positive real axis looks like this, right? I mean, the function which it defines looks like this. And the linear polynomial looks like this, right? And the next one, the quadratic, looks like this. And then the cubic, now maybe I take now another color because otherwise it gets too messy here. Cubic looks like this. and so on, right? And so you see that near zero, it's clear that, or it seems at least like the constant monomial is actually dominating everything, right? If you go away from zero, if you now go away from zero, then of course constant monomial stays equally important, but not really, because the others get more and more important, right? So its importance will not dominate as much, right? It will still, for some time, it will still dominate, but you can think that at some point this monomial, the linear one, gets the coefficient of a linear one, if you want, gets more important, right? Because and then gradually the quadratic one will get more important, right? The quadratic one will get more important, and so on, right? And so, and at the end, if you go to infinity, the highest monomial will be the most important, and so on, right? So now that's not at all a proof, but you can imagine that the signs which are in front of these monomials, close to zero, clearly that sign will dominate from the constant coefficient. When you could hope, or it's a bit adventurous, that when the sign of a linear one will dominate at some point, and when the sign of the next one, etc. So we start here with minus 120, and then here we have plus 106. So maybe now it will actually increase. I've already drawn it like this, actually, right? So maybe at some point now it will increase, but then comes the minus 19, which gets more and more important. So maybe it will actually will lose some acceleration, or it will even decrease again or something like this, right? And then comes a minus 4, which might make this even stronger. And then comes the x to a 4 at some point, which is dominating everything, and it will probably be like this, right? And so that's a bit the idea, you see. And now you see the way I've drawn it, it's not what happens in this case, right? Because I said there are three positive roots. Here it looks like there is only one positive root. But what you see is it looks like there is one, right? And one would have been possible by what we will prove. So if we didn't know that it's a real rooted polynomial, then we knew only from Descartes' rule of signs, or from our version of it, which Descartes did not even know yet. We know that there are three or one positive roots, okay? And here it looks like one, right? So here it looks like one. Well, this is really, you know, it's not a proof at all. It's just, you can imagine. Still, it seems extremely fortunate that this is really true, right? So we have to prove it. We have to prove it. And of course, an idea of how to prove it is that derivatives will play a big role, because if you look at the derivative of this polynomial, this would be 4x to the 3 minus 12x squared and so on, minus 38x plus 106, right? So you see the number of, so you see the coefficient of sines of a derivative is this one, right? So it's very closely related to the coefficient of sines, to the sequence of sines of a coefficients of the original polynomial. Okay, I think we can start right into the middle of things. Okay, so we have first to define some technicalities. So we will speak about first some notation. So we need a notation for the, well, in fact, we will look at polynomial. So for example, we need a notation like Rx D is all the polynomials in the variable x of degree less than or equal d. That's a notation. And for technical reasons, it's convenient to allow that d is even a real number, right? So, of course, if you want, then you could here take the lower Gauss brackets. You could take the integer part of d. Well, you have to be careful because, yeah, no, that's okay. And I introduce this notation for later purposes. I also introduce it even for the polynomial ring in several variables. And I allow that the coefficient ring is a commutative ring. We won't need this now. But it should be a commutative ring with 0 is not equal to 1. Otherwise, this polynomial ring doesn't even make sense, right? Because if 0 is 1, then this, the same must be true in every extension ring, and but the ring with 0 equal 1 is always the 0 ring, right? And then I cannot adjoin a variable here. So this is often forgotten in the literature everywhere, but this is an important assumption if you want to build polynomial rings in one or more variables. Okay, so that's just a notation, and so let's move on. And the degree of a zero polynomial, I define it always to be minus infinity, right? That's a good convention, I guess. So it will always be in this set here. So for example, so this leads to the fact that this is actually always an abelian subgroup of the additive group of this polynomial ring, right? Okay, and if you have, for example, here if A is a field, then it's a subvector space. The zero is always in there. Okay, the Taylor formula for polynomials. Suppose K is a field of characteristic 0. D is a non-negative integer, and F is a polynomial of degree at most D in one variable, and A is an element of this field K. Then F equals the sum from K equals 0 to D of the kth derivative of f evaluated in A divided by k factorial and times x minus a to the k. right? So, well, there are a few comments. So the kth derivative is I take a derivative k times, right? What is the derivative here? I'm dealing here with an arbitrary field. Well, that's derivative in the formal sense, formal derivative of polynomials, right? And the k factorial, okay, k factorial is k times k minus 1, etc., times 1. And so I can really divide by this, because in a field of characteristic 0, the rational numbers are always contained, yeah, or can be canonically embedded. So every positive integer corresponds then to an element of k which is invertible, because it is not zero. Okay, so all that makes sense. So we have to prove it. The proof is easy. So the formal derivative commutes with the ring automorphism, which is given by P maps to P of x plus a, right? So this is an evaluation homomorphism. It fixes the elements from K, and it's a ring homomorphism, and it maps x to x plus a. And it's actually an automorphism because it has an inverse, namely the same thing with x will be mapped to x minus a. And that's obviously, so you see easily that this is a bijective and therefore a ring automorphism. And this derivative commutes with this ring automorphism. Why is this? Well, that's by the chain rule, right? So if you take first the derivative, so if you have a polynomial over k in one variable, p, and when you take first derivative and you evaluate it when in x plus a, then that is the same as p of x plus a derivative, right? Why is this? That's by the chain rule, because this is p prime of x plus a, and then the derivative of x plus a. But what is this? This is of course 1. Okay. And yeah, what the chain rule for formal differentiation works over any, so yeah, let's say I have f and g. Probably we define the formal derivation once over fields at least. So let k be a field, and I have polynomials f and g, and I look at f of g. So that means I plug in for x, I plug in g. It's again an evaluation homomorphism, but evaluating in a polynomial. F of g, so from analysis you would say f composed with g, but we don't deal with functions here, we really deal with polynomials, right? I mean, they define functions, but sometimes we really need the polynomials. F of g, the derivative of f of g is the derivative of f evaluated in g times the derivative of g, right? That's the chain rule. How do you prove a chain rule? All this is a reminder, right? You should know all these things. Well, you see easily that it's enough to prove it in the case where f is of a form x to a k. So you only have to prove that g to a k prime equals k times g to the k minus 1, because the derivative of x of k, x to the k is k times x to the k minus 1, right? And now I have plugged in g times g prime. And where, how do you get this? You get this by the product rule, right? I mean, a product rule for a product with several factors, right? You know the product rule if you have two factors, and if you have more than two factors, it's quite similar. You have just, you can prove it by the other, by the product rule for two factors, by induction. So for several factors, it's just, you take one factor, you derive it, you take its derivative, and you do this with every factor, and you sum up everything. I mean, in the product, you take the derivative of one of the factors, and otherwise you the other factors are kept. And when you do this for all the factors, and when you add everything up, right? And you see that this is exactly this, right? Because you have k factors. Each time you take the derivative of one of them, that gives a g prime. All the other factors you let like this, right? And you do this with each of the k factors, so you get this k here. Okay. So, since this commutes with ring automorphism, I say that we can suppose that A equals zero. So why is this? So let's see. So let's delete these things. Why can we suppose without loss of generality that A is zero? So we want to prove this for all F, right? So, but when f runs over all polynomials, f of, let me see, f of x minus a runs also through all polynomials, right? So, because, for example, this is an automorphism. Also, if I write minus a instead of plus a, of course. So, it's enough to prove for all f that f of x minus a equals this sum, and I plug in instead of f of x minus a, of course, here. And when I take its kth derivative, and then when I evaluate it in a, when I divide by k factorial, and then here x minus a to a k. Right? And now, since I said that taking derivative commutes with evaluation, I can replace this here. This is the same as k times the kth derivative of f evaluated in x minus a, right? And when this evaluated, now that's the blue thing here, right? That's the blue thing. But when I evaluate this here in a, right? So if I evaluate here now this in A, when I get here the kth derivative of F evaluated in A minus A, that's in zero, right? So what we have to prove is that F of X minus A equals the sum of K equals zero to D F of the kth derivative of f at zero divided by k factorial x minus a to the k, right? And now instead of proving this, I can, of course, substitute x by x plus a here, because I could reverse this. So, so all I have to show is that f of x, and that's actually f, right? Is, so if x is replaced by x, when it's just, if I replace x by x in f, when it's just f, of course, is, is exactly this thing, right? Okay, good. Yeah, sometimes people get confused because if I replace here x with x plus a, if I replace here x by x plus a, people sometimes tend to do this here also, replacing f by f of x plus a. But now this is already a scalar here. You don't, there is no variable here anymore, right? Because I've already evaluated here in zero, so don't do this. Okay, so, and now we have to prove only this. We have to prove only this here. And that's pretty clear because, well, you just take, well, if you derive f k times, right, and when you evaluate it in zero, think about what that does, right? So you get you get the, I mean, if f is zero, if k is zero, when you get the constant coefficient of f, right? If k equals one, when you get, think about it, when the constant coefficient will be neutralized by the derivative, right? And the linear coefficient gets the constant one, right? So when you get the coefficient of a linear term, so you get and that's actually one factorial is one times the linear term, zero factorial is also one, by the way. So and when you get for k equal 2, you get you derive 2 times, so what you will get is the coefficient of a quadratic term, but multiplied with 2 times 1, with 2 factorial, right? So in general, you get k factorial times the coefficient of, times the coefficient of x to a k in f. That's what you get, right? And yeah, and then that's just writing f using its coefficients, because these are just the coefficients, right? So it's really easy. So that's the Taylor formula for polynomials. Yes. So now suppose, so now we will actually prove what I already said for real numbers, at least, which you know already from high school, that on the real line, if you go far out versus you approach plus infinity somehow, when the sign of the values of your polynomial is determined by the highest by the sign of the highest coefficient, right? If you go to minus infinity, it's a bit more complicated. You have to look also at the coefficient, you have to look at the exponent of the highest monomial. If it's an even exponent, everything is like before. If it's an odd one, you have to change, you have to take into account an additional sign, right? And if you are close to zero, then the constant coefficient matters, right? So that's what we will now prove, and we will also have a more quantitative statement. So we can say, we can give a bound. So if the absolute value of x is bigger than this thing here, which depends on the coefficients of a polynomial, then we know that the sine of f of x is given by the sine of x, right? So because this works for plus and for minus infinity, I approach plus or minus infinity, right? It's given by the sine of x to the alpha k, because I said you have to take into account the highest exponent appearing here, times the sine of highest coefficient, right? And for when I'm close to zero, that means that 1 over the absolute value of x is big, right? So, and I can exactly give this condition. And x should be different from 0, right? Here also x is not plus or minus infinity. That's the same thing in some sense. Okay, when I have a very similar thing with the smallest coefficient, yeah. Here I have supposed that all the coefficients are non-zero. I've only listed those that are non-zero, but I've written them in an ordered way, right? So that the exponents alpha I here are ordered, they are non-negative integers, they are ordered, and these are the coefficients, right? So I ignore the coefficients which are zero. I don't even list them. And that works for an ordered field even, right? Not just for real numbers. I can do that for an ordered field. And this makes really sense here because CK is, all coefficients are non-zero. So I can divide by CK or by C1 or by its absolute value. Okay. So this is just an easy technical thing. Let's do it. Okay. So for all x with absolute value greater than this, when the maximum of 1 and this, so I take the sum of all absolute values of coefficients except the highest one, and I divide by the highest one. Then we have that the sum from I equal 1 to k minus 1 ci x to the alpha I, so I have plugged in the x into the polynomial, except that I did not take into account the highest monomial. And this is less than or equal by the triangle inequality, which is satisfied by by the absolute value. So let's see again, 118. This triangle inequality here. And I have also this multiplicativity of the absolute value. So this is sum, less than or equal to sum from I equal 1 to k minus 1, absolute value of ci, absolute value of x to the alpha I. And then, since 1 is less than or equal to the absolute value of x, it's less than or equal, I can always take here alpha k minus 1, right? So, because each alpha I is less than or equal alpha k minus 1, and because the absolute value is greater than or equal 1. So I use probably monotonicity of multiplication and monotonicity of addition here at least. Okay, and then this is, now I can divide here by the absolute value of CK and I multiply here with it. And then, because this does not depend on I anymore now, I can factor it out here, and also, So that's less than the absolute value of x. So I get now the absolute value of x to be alpha k minus 1 times the absolute value of x. And I get this thing, right? So I see that the highest monomial absolute value of the highest monomial. So the highest monomial in absolute value is greater than when the absolute value of rest. And so I see that, so now it's easy to see that this dominates the sign, right? So very easy to see that the sign is now given by the sign of this, right? So let's see. So if A and B are in this ordered field, and the absolute value of A is smaller than the absolute value of B, when the sine of B plus A is the sine of B. That's what's behind, right? So, yeah, now you can distinguish several cases. So, if B is positive, then I have that minus A plus B, I have minus A, when B plus A positive follows from B greater than minus A, right, which follows by case distinction. If minus A is negative, that's trivial. If minus A is positive, then it equals the absolute value of A, and then you get it from this, right? Because when these absolute values here, you don't need the absolute value here because both are positive. And if B is negative, when B plus A negative follows from minus B greater than A. So I think it's like this, right? Because when the absolute value of B is minus B, and then again case distinction to see that this is okay, so it's easy, right? Just to show you that everything I don't explain is usually easy. Okay. I hope after a while you will trust me more. And no, but the best thing is not to trust me. The best thing is always to do it, just to show it yourself. And then the other thing. So let's perhaps copy this here. So the other thing which remained to show is this. Okay, so let's do it. So the absolute value of this is less, it's very similar, it's less than this. And because the absolute value of x is less than or equal 1, I can here now use the smallest exponent. Alpha 1 plus 1. So at alpha 2, I can replace alpha 2, since alpha 2 is greater than or equal alpha 1 plus 1, I can replace it by alpha 1 plus 1 and equally for alpha 3, etc. But now this does not depend anymore on I, so I can factor it out here, and here I keep this, and now I've supposed that 1 over the absolute value of x is greater than this thing here. So I get here this times 1 over the absolute value of x, so I can do away with this plus 1 here. Yeah, I get this thing, right? And then the sign is determined by this, by the smallest monomial in some sense, right? Okay. And that's, again, using what I just showed before. Okay, so reminder, let k be a field and f a polynomial in one variable over k and a an element of this field, when the multiplicity of a in f is the supremum over all k in n0 such that x minus a to the k divides f in k adjoint x, right? And yeah, since this ring is factorial, it has a unique, it's an UFD, a unique factorization domain. So, yeah, you know that that this is just the multiplicity with which this prime polynomial appears in the prime decomposition of f. Okay, there is one exception. If f is the zero polynomial, when this is true for every k, every polynomial divides the zero polynomial, and then the supremum should be infinity. So it's just a multiplicity of root a in f. If it is a root, otherwise the multiplicity is zero, right? With a convention or by definition that the zero polynomial has each element as a root of multiplicity infinity, right? That makes actually a lot of sense if you think about it. This is called the multiplicity of a in f. We have that the multiplicity is infinity if and only if f is the zero polynomial, and that's independently of a, we have this equivalence, right? And we have that the multiplicity is greater than or equal 1 if a is in fact a root, right? We call a multiple, we call a multiple root of f if a multiplicity is at least 2, right? And we call it a k-fold root of f for some positive integer k if a multiplicity is k. Well, I say here it should be a positive integer because, well, a zero-fold root that's not a root actually, right? I mean, I would not be opposed to that terminology actually, but it's a bit strange or a bit misleading if you speak of a root which is actually not a root, a zero-fold root. Okay. Okay, of course, if I have two-fold, when I will speak of a double root, if I have a three-fold, when I'll speak of a triple root, and so on. So if I say double root, some people, if I say double root, they mean multiple root, right? They mean of multiplicity at least 2. But if I say double root, I hopefully always will mean a root of multiplicity exactly 2, right? Okay. In case that characteristic of case 0 one has that multiplicity, you can actually characterize it in a different way. You can say the multiplicity is the supremum over all non-negative integers k, such that for each number, for each integer between 0 and k minus 1, a is the root of a corresponding derivative, right? So you can actually count how many derivatives of f, including f itself, f it's zeroth derivative, how many derivatives do actually, how many consecutive derivatives do actually have a as a root, and in this way you can also count the multiplicity. That's in characteristic zero, right? So if you remember, I mean, that's the case that is interesting for us. So, yeah, as one can see easily, you should probably know it, but maybe let's do this exercise, right? So, so the thing is that, okay, let's see. So the multiplicity of A in F prime is the multiplicity of A in F minus 1. If, let's see, so if F of A is 0, if A is root of F, at least if f prime is not if f prime is a zero polynomial, okay, if f is a zero polynomial, this is in some sense also true, because this would be infinity, but if f is not a zero polynomial and f prime is, but okay, if f is not a zero polynomial and f prime is, because we are in characteristic zero, that can only happen if f is a constant polynomial, but then a couldn't be a root of it, right? Okay, so the case that f is a zero polynomial, f is not a zero polynomial, but f prime is a zero polynomial cannot occur, right? So I think the only thing we have to care about is that f is not a zero polynomial. Yeah, well, if f is a zero polynomial, then in some sense it's, if a is a root, then if f is a zero polynomial, then this would be infinity, that would also be infinity, then in some sense it would also be true, but I don't want to define what's infinity minus 1. So I say f is not a zero polynomial. I assume a is a root. And now I claim this, right? So now I claim this. So why is this? So as I said, the degree of f must be at least 1, since it has a root, and so the degree of f prime is at least 0, so it's not a zero polynomial, so then f prime is not a zero polynomial. And now write, well, I don't know if I, maybe that will come out later again, or maybe I don't need it, but now write f as x minus a times g, x minus a, sorry, to a k times g for some positive integer k, such that g is a polynomial with g of a is not zero. And then calculate f prime. So f prime equals k times x minus a to k minus 1. I said k is a positive integer, so that makes sense. Times g, so this is product rule, times x minus a to k times g prime. And now this is x minus a to k minus 1 times k times g plus x minus a times g prime. Now if I evaluate the polynomial which I mark here in yellow, if I evaluate this polynomial at a, then I get, when this here gets zero, because I have this factor x minus a, and this is k times g of a, but g of a was not zero. And now it's important, since we are in characteristic zero, with k, this positive integer will be different from zero, right? That's important. So if I evaluate this in a, it's important that this is different from zero. So, and so I see that the multiplicity of a in f prime is k minus 1, exactly, right? So, and if I have this together with the fact that multiplicity is greater than or equal to 1 if and only if it's a root, then you get immediately these things here, right? And so also please be aware that, I mean, that's not interesting for us. We look at characteristic zero anyway, but please be aware that yes, we, in other characteristics there might be problems, right? So there is however one thing, I mean, so you know the problem was with integer k here, and which could be zero, and for k equal 1 that's not a problem. K equal 1 is never zero in no field. K equal 2 in characteristic 2 is already zero. So, and because 1 is not zero, you actually get that, but that's not important at all for us now, but you get actually that a is a multiple root. Let's write this. A is a multiple root of f if and only if f of a equals f prime of a equals zero. So that's true in any characteristic. True in any characteristic. For fields of any characteristic. Characteristic. I've just mentioned this, although so, but this works only for multiple roots, so that means roots of multiplicity at least 2. If you had here multiplicity at least 3, then I couldn't write f of a equals f prime of a equals f prime prime of a equals 0. Right. Okay. Okay, but maybe I shouldn't have told this, but you are not caring about these other characteristics. And what I wrote, I mean, it's perhaps important in characteristic zero, but in characteristic zero, it follows from this, right? Okay. And maybe that's the definition of multiple root that you know from high school, in fact. But it's not the same in other characteristics. Okay, definition 155. Let k less than or equal be an ordered field and zero a non and f a non-zero polynomial over it. The number of positive roots counted with multiplicity of f is, I introduced some notation, mu of f is the sum over all positive elements of k over their multiplicities. Yeah, so it makes sense because, I mean, a polynomial which is not a zero polynomial has only finitely many roots, so only finitely many of these terms are non-zero, right? So it makes really sense. And so you can also see it in that way. If I write f as g times such a product of linear factors with roots ai, positive roots, and g does not have positive roots, when we have a multiplicity of f is m, right? You can also see it in that way. And the second definition is the number of sign changes. So if I have a polynomial in this form and I write only the exponents that actually appear and I order them, and then, yes, the coefficients are these. These are all non-zero because I list only those that really appear. We define the number of sign changes in the coefficients of f. As I mean, I did it already informally. A number of sign changes is a number of positions such that, I mean, the number of positions, if you want, in between the signs, right? Because I have k signs now. I have now k signs. Maybe plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, minus, minus. Okay, and so in this case this would be 8, and so I need 7 positions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I do it this way. I count up to 7. Don't count the last one. But when I always look at this and the next one, right? And I sign is always plus 1, 0, or minus 1. And I look if the signs are the same or not. This is the number of, and the sign, okay, no, it cannot, the sign is never zero, sorry, because this is, the zero is not in there, that's important. I don't count the zeros, right? I don't count the zeros. I list really only the monomials that are actually there. So the signs here are plus 1 or minus 1. And I just count how often the sign changes. So in this case, it's 1, 2, it's here, it's here. Let's do it in red. It's here, it's here. It's here, it's here, it's here. And then never again, right? So here I have 5 sign changes. Okay, let R be a real closed field and F a polynomial, not the zero polynomial, over it in one variable, univariate polynomial, when mu of f and sigma of f have the same parity. That's the thing that Descartes, I think, did not claim or probably did not know already, and Gauss proved later. I don't know, about 200 years later. I'm not sure if Gauss was the first one though. So write f like this, and so we see I have our coefficients, and also I write it factorized like this with the positive roots, right? Right, and now I so we alpha I are the exponents, we see I have our non-zero coefficients. We ai is our positive roots, and g is a polynomial which doesn't have a positive root, and I have to take care that I list that the terms of this sum are ordered according to the exponents. Since r is real closed, I know that the sine of g is the same on all positive elements of R, right? So the sine of g of x equals the sine of g of y for all x and y positive elements from R. Because if I had different sign, then I would have a zero by the intermediate value theorem, right? Which is true for polynomials over real closed fields. Which holds for polynomials over real closed fields. And when now if a sign is minus one, then I just can just replace f by minus f, that neither changes the multiplicities of the roots, nor the that neither changes the multiplicities of the roots, nor the sign, the number of sign changes, right? So I can assume that g is positive without loss of generality on all positive elements of R. So, but then if it is positive on the positive axis, let's say, then we know that the lowest and highest coefficient must be positive, right? Because the behavior close to zero on the positive axis is determined by the smallest coefficient by smallest coefficient I mean the coefficient belonging to a polynomial to a monomial of smallest degree, which is actually there, and the sign behavior for large close to infinity is close to plus infinity is determined by the sign of a coefficient of a highest monomial, right? So, and I write here just lowest and highest coefficient in that, to understand in that sense, right? Now the claim follows from mu of f equals m, and sine of c1 is, so let's see, the sine of c1 is minus 1 to vm, I say. Okay, so why is this? And the sine of ck is 1. That's because look at this representation of f, right? How do I get the lowest coefficient? How do I get to C1 out here? Well, the C1 is certainly the lowest coefficient of G times the product of the lowest coefficients of these linear factors. So it's the lowest coefficient of G times minus A1 times minus A2, etc. But the lowest and highest coefficient of G are positive, so it's just the sine of minus A1 times minus A2 and so on. So it's minus 1 to m. And for the highest, it's the highest coefficient of G, which is positive, times the highest coefficient of this times the product of the highest coefficients of these linear factors, which is always 1. So it's a sine of ck is 1. So so maybe this is a bit too fast. So if m is odd, then mu of f, which equals m, is odd. The sum of the multiplicities of the positive roots is odd. And And the number of sign changes is then also odd, because the sign of ck is 1, so I start with a plus. When of ck minus 1, etc., I don't know. And the last one is minus 1 to some odd number, so it's minus, right? So the number of sign changes, clearly, because in the end I go from plus to minus, the number of sign changes must also be odd, right? Otherwise I would here, it would here end with a plus again, right? If I change the sign an odd number of times, I change the sign, right? So if m is even, if on the other hand m is even, then mu of f is even, because it's equal to m, and the signs are like follows: the sine of ck is plus 1, etc. And the last one is again plus, and then I must here have an even number of sign changes, right? So the parity is the same. So after all, that was actually not... not so hard to see. So so I said Descartes didn't know it. Well, maybe he did not state it, since it's so easy, maybe he has actually known it. But it's an important detail, right? It can really help, as we saw already, to determine the exact number of positive roots. Okay. So now we relate the mu of f with mu of f prime and sigma of f with sigma of f prime. As I already said, we would try to use the derivative for the proof. So I just want to make this cover sheet a little bigger. So let R be a real closed field and F be a non-constant polynomial over R in one variable. When mu of F is less than or equal mu of F prime plus 1, and sigma of F is less than or equal sigma of F prime plus 1. The second statement is easy to prove, right? Because the sine of, if a sequence of signs of coefficients in F is plus, minus, minus, plus, 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 minus, 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 right? When the one for f prime is the same, right? Except the sign for the constant coefficient, because the constant coefficient goes away when I take a derivative. The other coefficients might be multiplied with the exponent, right? With the respective exponent. But since we are in characteristic zero, that doesn't make any coefficient into zero, and it also won't change the sign, of course. So f prime will have the same sequence except for the last one. So I just lose So the number of sign changes can be at most one more, right? So the only sign change that f can have and f prime doesn't have is the last one here, right? So it can be at most one more. So I could actually add here, I didn't do this because I Yeah, but I could add here that it's greater than or equal with number of sign changes of f prime, right? But I didn't do this. So the second statement is easy to prove. For the first statement, suppose that the alpha between a1 to am are the positive roots of f. I order them in increasing way here. Since R is real closed, there exist roots b1 up to bm minus 1 that lie in between, right? That interlace here, vb i's interlace, va i's in some sense, right? So that's by the intermediate, by Rolle's theorem, right? That's by Rolle's theorem, remember. I apply Rolle's theorem m minus 1 times. Let's look at Rolle's theorem again. You should know it from high school, but here we have already proven it for real closed fields, right? So it was this thing here. Between two roots of a polynomial, there exists in between one of a derivative, right? And strictly in between, in fact. So between a1 and a2, there is a root b1 of a derivative. Between a2 and a3, there is a root b2, and so on. Okay. Now, the number of the multiplicity of mu of f prime, which is the sum of all multiplicities of positive roots of f prime, what are the roots of f prime? We don't know exactly. We know, of course, that the bi's are roots of f prime, so we should, of course, count these. These will actually contribute. Every root bi will contribute at least one, right? So I count all these multiplicities. And then the ai's, I don't know if they are still roots of f prime. If they were multiple roots, yes, they are, right? So so maybe we should count my multiplicity of ai in f prime. This could sometimes be zero, sometimes be greater than zero. And I don't know, I mean, there might be other roots of f prime, but which contribute, but I just don't care. I just say this is greater than or equal this, right? And this is greater than or equal multiplicities of the sum of the multiplicities of ai in f prime. I just keep this first sum. And these contribute at least always one. But since the bi's are actually roots of f prime, they have multiplicity at least one, right? So, the multiplicity of ai in f prime is the multiplicity of ai in f minus one. I've already explained this, right? So f is not a zero polynomial, so there is no problem with this. This minus 1, I added m times, so I get here minus m plus m minus 1. So I get this, and this is, of course, since the ai's were here, really all positive roots of f, this is really mu of f minus 1, right? So I have mu of f prime is less than or equal, is greater than or equal, sorry. Mu of f prime is greater than or equal mu of f minus 1, and that's that gives me this inequality, the other one I had already. Okay, so in the situation of this lemma, sigma of f prime less than or equal sigma of f holds trivially. I already explained this, I said I could add this here. But mu of f prime less than or equal mu of f fails in general, right? As the following example shows, namely f equals x minus 1 squared plus 1. So let's see. In this case, f prime is 2 times x minus 1 plus 1, so it's 2x minus 1. And mu of f prime, so we only root this 1 half, and its multiplicity is 1, so we, so mu of f prime is 1, and mu of f is of course 0, because f doesn't have a root in the real closed field R, right? Because if I evaluate f anywhere, then I get 1 plus a square, which is strictly positive. So mu of f is 0. Okay, that was easy. Good. So the analogy between sigma and mu, between the number of sign changes and the multiplicities, the sum of the multiplicities of positive roots, is not perfect, right? But we see where there is some connection, and now we make this become really to Descartes' rule of signs. Let R be a real closed field. When mu of f is less than or equal sigma of f, so the number of positive roots counted with multiplicities, less than or equal number of sign changes for every non-zero polynomial. I mean, the number of sign changes of a zero polynomial we did not define. If we defined it as infinity, then it would... yeah, the number of sign changes of a zero polynomial we did not define, right? And also the mu of a zero polynomial we did not define, sorry. So, okay, so f should not be the zero polynomial. So, proof by induction on the degree of a polynomial. If a degree is zero, then mu of f is, so it's a constant non-zero polynomial, so it doesn't have a root at all. So mu of f is zero, and number of sign changes is also zero, so it's okay. So now we assume by induction hypothesis that we have already proved it for all polynomials of degree d minus 1. We suppose that d is now... greater than or equal to 1, I guess, so I should change this here in the lecture notes. Okay, so d is a positive integer, and by induction hypothesis I suppose that it's already proven for polynomials of degree d minus 1. Now mu of f is by lemma 157, it's less than or equal mu prime, mu of f prime plus 1. By the induction hypothesis, since f prime has 1 degree less, it's less than or equal mu of, it's less than or equal sigma of f prime plus 1. But this is less than or equal sigma of f plus 1. By this here, by this obvious fact, and therefore Okay, so this should stay here. Okay. Therefore, sigma of f is less than or equal sigma, mu of f is less than or equal sigma of f, since we have the same parity, right? So, since we have the same parity, for example, if mu of f is odd, and sigma of f is also odd, so this must be an even number, and therefore I can again subtract here the minus 1, right? I get the same inequality even if I subtract minus 1 on the right-hand side. So that's a nice trick. Okay. So let's look at an example. Let R be a real closed field. And I take this polynomial here, x to the 4 minus 5x to the 3 minus 21x to the square plus 115x minus 150. When the sigma of f is 3, a number of sign changes here from plus to minus, minus, from minus to plus, from plus to minus. So I have three sign changes. And therefore the number of positive roots counted with multiplicity must be 3 or 1. 2 is not possible because of a parity. And 0 is also not possible. And bigger than 3 is also not possible because of Descartes' theorem. And now let's look at the number of negative roots in order to find out something about that. We look at f of minus x because the positive roots are negated negative roots of f, and the multiplicities are the same, of course. So I have to change the sign for all odd degree monomials. So 115 becomes minus 115, for example. And then the number of sign changes is here plus, plus, minus, minus, minus. So I have one sign change exactly, and a number of roots must therefore be 1 because it must be less than or equal 1 and must have the same parity. So I have one negative root, right? And now here I actually have only one positive root. And I don't see this from Descartes' rule of sign, but there is a trick. So I don't see it by applying Descartes' rule of sign to the original polynomial, but there is a trick to see it if I apply it to another polynomial, namely this polynomial here. Okay, I see where it's actually what I meant here is one can verify that sigma of this polynomial is 1, the number of sign changes is 1, right? The number of sign changes, so I think what you provoke by multiplying with 1 plus x is a bit that some signs, some plus and minuses could neutralize each other, right? Because, well, you know, take a polynomial 7 x to a 3 minus 2x plus 2 and then what I do here is I add x times this polynomial, right? I add x times this polynomial, so it's like minus 2x squared plus 2x, right? And I add it up, so I have here 2 and, here is actually 0. And I have here 5, that should be x. Oh, sorry, I meant actually x squared here, sorry. 5x squared and 7x to the 3. You see that well, the idea, I guess, is that you shift it a little bit, right? And then, so you hope that some pluses and minuses somehow neutralize or something. Anyway, you can calculate this. I mean, it's no fun to compute this because you have here, you take it to the power of 22. I mean, I didn't do it for fun. I think probably there was no power with a lower exponent that would give the same thing, right? So you should compute this with a computer algebra system, or you just trust me, right? Or you do it by hand. I don't know how much time it takes. Probably not such a good idea. So from which we get this, right? Because we get sigma of f is the same as sigma of this thing. Because what did I add? I added the root minus 1 with a multiplicity of 22. That doesn't affect the positive roots nor their multiplicities. Okay? So it's clear that this is the same. And by Descartes' rule of sign, this mu of this is less than or equal sigma of this. Less than or equal when the number of sign changes, so it's less than or equal 1. But the parity is the same, so it is equal to 1. Okay? And so f has exactly 2 roots in R, namely 2 simple ones. Simple root means 1 fold, so a root that's not a multiple root. 1 positive and 1 negative. And we have derived this with Descartes' rule of sign. We don't even have to compute the roots. We now know that there is 1 positive, 1 negative. We both have multiplicity 1. So it's a great thing, you see. I don't have to compute the roots or something like this. Let R be a real closed field. We call a polynomial f over R in one variable real rooted if it has no root. The algebraic closure is actually R adjoint square root of minus 1, right? So if it has no root in the algebraic closure, which would not lie in R. I referred here to 1, 4, 12, probably to remind you that R adjoint I is the algebraic closure already, right? Because it's algebraically closed and it's of course algebraic over R. Okay. So, next proposition. Let R be a real closed field and F a polynomial over R when we're following R equivalent. I don't want it slanted here, so it should be not be italic. Okay, I should correct this in the script. When we're following our equivalent, f is real rooted and there are roots a1 up to ad such that f is c times the product of these linear factors of x minus ai. Yeah, I mean, that's a consequence of a generalized fundamental theorem of algebra, I guess. For a implies b, use the fundamental theorem 1 for 12 or 1 for 14. 1 for 12 means that... was that after adjoining square root of minus 1, it's algebraically closed, and 1 through 14, for example, was this version that the irreducible and monic polynomials are these quadratic ones of a special form and these linear ones. These quadratic ones of a special form don't have a root in R, so their roots would lie in the algebraic closure but not in R, so they cannot appear in a prime factorization of F. So if I take, for example, the second version of a fundamental theorem, I get such a prime decomposition here. And or I say I do a prime decomposition in the algebraic closure, and but when I see that since there are no roots, since all roots lie in R already, the linear factors must all look like this. So I can use either 1 for 12 or 1 for 14. That was A implies B. For B implies A, I think is completely trivial because, yeah, right, if you plug in here an element which is not in R, then you get that F is not zero in this, because all the linear factors don't give zero. Okay, theorem 1.5.13, suppose R is a real closed field and F is a polynomial in one variable over it, but it's not a constant polynomial. And suppose it's real rooted, when F prime is also real rooted, and mu of F prime is less than or equal mu of F. Well, I suppose that F is not constant because I don't want that F prime can be a zero polynomial, because when mu of F prime wouldn't be defined. So the derivative of a real rooted of a non-constant real rooted polynomial is real rooted, and the number of its positive roots counted with multiplicities is bound from above by the respective number for F. So why did I refer to 1.5.8? I said that in 1.5.8, I said that mu of F prime less than or equal mu of F fails in general. But here I prove that for real rooted, it holds, right? So using 1.5.12, we write F in this form because it's real rooted. And this time I want the probably want the AIs to be distinct, because otherwise why should I introduce these exponents alpha I? We will see. Oh yeah, I want the AIs to be distinct, pairwise distinct, yes. And I order them according to the unique order that I have on my field R, on my real closed field R. Since R is real closed, there exist roots B1 up to Bn minus 1 of F prime that interlace via roots of F, right? Again, because I have this Rolle's theorem, right? And so let's copy this maybe. Yeah, and so F has a lot of real roots. And in between there are then still a lot of roots of f prime. And now for let's look at the multiplicities also. Let's count them with multiplicities. Multiplicities of the AIs are these alpha i's, of course. And therefore, multiplicities of the AIs in f prime are these alpha i's decreased by 1, right? So now let's see. The degree of f prime is, of course, greater than or equal. Oh, actually, I see that I have lost my cover sheet. I hope it was not long time ago. So let's now take again one. So the degree of f prime is of course greater than or equal the sum of all multiplicities over all elements in R, multiplicities of A in F prime, right? Actually, we will want to show here equal, because we want to show that F prime is real rooted, right? But it's greater than or equal, right? And now that's certainly greater than or equal if we just concentrate on some elements from R, candidates for roots, right? Namely the AI and the BI, right? The AI are certainly good candidates because they might be multiple roots of F, and then they will still be roots of F prime. And the BIs are for sure roots of F prime. And for the moment, we don't know if there are others, right? But we don't care. We have greater than or equal this. Okay. In fact, we will, I guess, show that there are no others, right? Yes, I guess we will show this. So we will have equality here in the end, but at the moment we don't know this. Anyway, the BIs are for sure roots, so we are multiplicities at least one, right? We are multiplicities at least one. So now comes really an estimation which might not be an equality, in fact, which will probably not turn out to be an equality in general, right? Because it might, of course, happen, I guess, that multiplicities of a BI or that a BI are multiple roots. So, but I have this estimate. And, the multiplicities of the AIs in F prime are these things, okay. But, so that's when the sum of the alpha I is the degree of F, of course, and then I have here minus n plus n minus 1. So that's the degree of f prime. So you see, sorry. I have, in fact, equality everywhere here, right? Because I have a chain of inequalities on both ends of a chain where it's the same thing. So I have here equality everywhere. So even that must be an equality. Meaning that these BIs are of multiplicity 1. Aha. So that's something I never noticed, that if f is real rooted, then the derivative of f is also real rooted. And the roots that the derivative has in addition to those of f, the roots of f prime that are not roots of f, they have multiplicity 1. I never noticed this, but this follows also from here. Yes. Okay. That makes somehow sense if you think, at least for real polynomials, intuitively makes sense, right? Because if f prime, if a derivative has a multiple root, how would that look like? Something like this, right? Here there would be a multiple root. Here there would be a multiple root of f prime, right? And that somehow, yeah, it looks like that cannot happen, because if you shift now the x-axis, when you see this must be a degree 4 polynomial, and somehow you did not, by having this here, you lose somehow two roots or something, right? Okay, I don't know really, but yeah, I guess it makes sense. It makes really sense. Okay. So once the degree of f prime equals this thing here, and mu of bi f prime must be 1. Yeah, right, now it's even written here. Okay, I did not rediscover it, I knew it already at some point, because exactly, because otherwise I would have a strict inequality here, and that's not possible. So it follows that roots of f prime are roots in the algebraic closure of f prime are contained in here. Because the multiplicities are as high, so the AIs and BIs are distinct, and the sum of the multiplicities in F prime is the degree. So there is definitely no room for non-real roots here. And also mu of BI F prime is 1. So that's what I remarked. So actually I knew it because I knew it already. So I rediscovered it just before. Okay, so because otherwise it would have here strict greater than, which is not possible, right? So now it follows that the roots in the algebraic closure of f prime are contained in are definitely contained in this set. Only the AIs and BIs can be roots. The BIs are, the AIs I don't know. In particular, f prime is real rooted. Now the AIs, remember, were ordered in this way here. They were ordered in this way, right? And the BIs were interlacing them. So now we can choose a K such that AK up to AN are the positive roots. Of F, in fact, not F prime, sorry. So of F, not F prime. We don't know if the AIs are roots of f prime, or we don't know which AIs are roots of f prime. Okay, so Yes, we are roots of positive roots of f. So if there is no positive root of f, when I take k equal to n plus 1, that's completely okay, right? And this means that there is no positive root of f. So now I look at the positive roots of f prime, and they are contained. There is an error here. So they are contained. So ak minus 1, if it exists, so if k is greater than or equal to, then ak minus 1 exists, and it's negative, right, by the choice of k. So if k is greater than or equal to, the positive roots of f prime, the roots of f prime were contained in the set of all a i's and b i's. And since there is this interlacing right here, I know that since ak minus 1 is not, since ak k minus 1 is not positive, I know that bk minus 2 is also not positive, and so on, if bk minus 2 exists. Okay, so anyway, so it's, you see, it's contained here. If k is greater than or equal to, or in the special case, if k equal 1, I cannot write this because bk minus 1 doesn't exist when it's contained here. And equal, I think that was really nonsense, so it's really contained here. I have to change this in the lecture notes. Okay. So if k is greater than or equal to, when mu of f prime is, so I count now the positive roots, so the candidates are bk minus 1, ak, and so on, right? These are the candidates. And so I count their multiplicities and I add them up, right? And I mean, not every AI must have been a root, right? And also the BK minus 1 could be negative, perhaps. But I don't care if it counts here when I have at least here an inequality, right? I have mu of f prime is less than or equal that. Okay, so, and this is always 1. These multiplicities are 1, as I have said here. And these multiplicities are the corresponding multiplicities in f minus 1, right? So I get here, 1 minus 1, so I get just mu of f here. Right, so mu of f prime is less than or equal mu of f, and in the special case where k equals to 1, the only thing that changes here that for I equal k, I don't have this term just because it doesn't make sense, just because b 1 minus 1 doesn't exist, b 0 doesn't exist, so yes, so, but nevertheless, even without this first term for I equal k, I have here less than or equal. But since I have now taken away this term, so there is one missing when so if k is 1, So if all roots of f were positive, when I have here, when I get, okay, let's write mu of f prime is less than or equal mu of a1 multiplicity of a1 in f, in f prime, sorry, and then plus sum from I equal to n, and then exactly what is written above here, right? Take exactly the same thing. And then this is mu of a1 f prime plus the sum from I equal 2 to n mu of a I f. And this is mu of multiplicity of a1 in f minus 1 plus the sum from I equal 2 to n, which I just had. And this is mu of f minus 1, right? So if all roots of f are real, if all roots of f are positive, then mu of f prime is less than or equal mu of f minus 1, in fact, right? When, yeah, that makes sense, right? When, I mean, if all roots of f are positive, when mu of f is the degree of f, right? And the degree of f prime is less than or equal to the degree of f minus 1, of course, and therefore mu of f prime is less than or equal to mu of f minus 1. You could also argue in this way, but I also just can say that the proof is similar. It gets even easier. So if k equals 1, when one sees similarly that mu of f equals mu of f minus 1, which is less than or equal mu of f. Okay, so now finally we get to Descartes' rule of signs for real rooted polynomials, and where it is exact. Where it is exact. So, in that, I don't know, that's perhaps something Descartes didn't really know. Let R be a real, and that will be very important for us. Let R be a real closed field when mu of f equals sigma of f for all real rooted f in Rx. So I can count with multiplicity the number of positive roots by just counting the number of sign changes in the sequence of coefficients for real rooted polynomials. So by theorem 159, it's enough to show that, so we have already from Descartes' general Descartes' rule of signs, we have already mu of f is less than or equal sigma of f. So we just have to show that mu of f is greater than or equal sigma to f for all real rooted f. And we show this by induction on the degree. So for degree 0, for degree 0, so we suppose the polynomial is not the 0 polynomial, right? Let's see. So this must probably be, yes, that's part of the definition of real rooted. Let's see where we defined real rooted. Yes, the zero polynomial has a root in the algebraic closure, which is not in R, for example, square root of minus 1, right? So the zero polynomial is not real rooted. So therefore, a real rooted polynomial is not a zero polynomial, and we can actually speak about mu of f and sigma von f for all real rooted f. Okay, so maybe I used that already. So if d is zero, so I have a constant polynomial, which is not a zero polynomial, then the multiplicities of positive roots are, of course, there are no positive roots, so sum of these multiplicities is zero. And the sign change, there are of course no sign changes because I have just one coefficient. So from induction step from d minus 1 to d, so I assume that it's already proved for degree d minus 1 polynomials, and again, I guess d should be here a positive integer. I have to correct this in the lecture notes. So mu of f is greater than or equal by 1, 5, 13 by what we have just shown, mu of f prime, right? That was specific for real rooted polynomials f. Non-constant real rooted polynomials f, which we have here, right? Because the degree is now positive. It's a non-constant polynomial. So by induction hypothesis applied to f prime, which has degree one less, we get that this is greater than or equal sigma of f prime, right? And why can I actually apply the induction hypothesis? For this I would need that f prime is real rooted, right? But that's by 1, 5, 13, because f is real rooted. Now sigma of f prime is greater than or equal sigma of f minus 1, that was 1, 5, 7, right? That was lemma 1, 5, 7. Let's go back. That was here. Sorry. Right. Sigma of f prime is greater than or equal sigma of f minus 1. And therefore, because of parity of sigma of f and mu of f and sigma of f are the same, I can again reinforce this a little bit, right? Can strengthen it a little bit. I can write this. Okay, so that's a trick. And that's it. That's it. So just to conclude for today, an example. So if I take so I have here a polynomial over the reals, over the real numbers. And right, and this it happens to be a polynomial, of course I chose it in that way. It happens to be a characteristic polynomial of a symmetric real matrix, right? So if I take a symmetric real matrix 1, 0, 1, 0, minus 2, 1, 1, 1, 0, that's a symmetric real matrix, a 3 by 3 matrix, symmetric. And its characteristic polynomial is the determinant of A minus X times the 3 by 3 identity matrix. And that's exactly this polynomial, right? So you can calculate it by the rule of Sarrus. So you have to take you have to multiply these three things with so this is here 1 minus x 2 plus xx, so I simplified it already a little bit, and then the next one would be to multiply these, but this is zero, right? So I don't need this, and the next one would be this, but it's again 0. So I don't need that one. And then with minus, I have to multiply v. Oh, sorry. With minus, I have to multiply v is 3. So this gives 2 plus x here. And then I have to multiply these, and it gets again with a minus, so I get this, and the other one is 0 again, right? Okay, so now we add these things up. Okay, so I multiply these two terms, so this is 2 plus x minus 2. X minus x squared times x plus 2x plus 1. So it's minus x to the 3 minus x squared, because x minus 2x is minus x. And then 2x, 2x plus 2x gives 4x here. Okay, it's exactly this. So this polynomial is real rooted, since it is a characteristic polynomial of a symmetric matrix. And that you know, right? You know that the eigenvalues, that a symmetric matrix has only real eigenvalues, doesn't have complex non-real eigenvalues, right? So it's a real rooted polynomial by linear algebra, by your basic knowledge in linear algebra. So by Descartes' rule, it has exactly one positive root, because Descartes' rule is now exact. Let's just count a number of sign changes. There is only one sign change, minus, minus, plus, plus, okay? And therefore it must have at least counted with multiplicity. It must have two negative roots. We could see if that comes also out from Descartes' rule of sign, because if I plug in minus x for x, then I get here a plus and here a minus, and then how many sign changes? I have plus, minus, minus, plus. I have two sign changes, right? So I have two negative roots if I count with multiplicity. Well, probably they will be distinct, but I don't know it right now. So anyway, that's it. So next time we will learn, now we can already count the number of roots. I can count the number of positive roots and also the number of negative roots by this little trick, substituting minus x for x. And of course, I see if 0 is a root, then I see the multiplicity of 0 as a root immediately, right? That's easy. So I can actually count the roots with multiplicities for real rooted polynomials, right? Positive roots, negative roots, and such things. But for general polynomials, it's more difficult. And next time we will learn how to count real zeros for general polynomials over real closed fields using Hermite's method. And we will even be able to count these roots with additional side conditions. Right now we had a side condition that the root should be positive or something like this, and next time we will even look at more complicated side conditions that are given by polynomial inequalities. And quite astonishingly, we will next time use what we have done this time to count roots counted without multiplicities. That looks strange at the first. But what is behind is Hermite's method, and you will learn about that next time. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed. So next time we will go to counting real zeros with Hermite's method. Thank you, and see you next time.